mechanism of action for the original antipsychotics was dopamine blockade. So in dopamine nerve cells, when there would be a release of dopamine into the synapse, for some reason it was judged that there was hyperactivity in the dopamine system. This is especially true in parts of the limbic system. Dopamine, as we're going to see, is found in many different parts of the brain. And so all the first generation antipsychotics came in and they blocked dopamine receptors. Unfortunately, they block dopamine receptors everywhere, not just in the limbic system. The newer agents have an effect on dopamine receptors, and they do produce to a greater or lesser degree dopamine blockade. But they do other things too. They have some effect on serotonin receptors as well. Now, let's take a look here. If we look at there's actually four parts of the brain where dopamine plays a critical role, but we're going to look at three of them in particular. All right, first off is in the limbic system. And here, the part of the limbic system that is implicated the most is called the nucleus accumbens. And it's some consider it to be kind of a pathway between limbic structures in the frontal lobes. And it is it's like a gate. And this gating mechanism is not working very well when people have schizophrenia, so they have hyperactivity in the nucleus accumbens. So you have increased dopaminergic activity here. The other two critical parts of the brain that are important for dopamine are the operation of the frontal lobes. We already talked about that when we talked about ADHD. Okay, and then also in the basal ganglia, the extrapyramidal system relies a lot on dopamine. Now, again, there are other places where dopamine are important, but we're just going to look at these three areas. So let's say then that you use a traditional antipsychotics, and what they do is they block dopamine receptors. Blocking them in the limbic system is probably what is almost certainly what's responsible for antipsychotic effects. But you block them here in the extrapyramidal system of the basal ganglia, and you start developing motor symptoms, the extrapyramidal side effects. And those are akathisia, which is probably one of the most unpleasant things. It's an intense inner sense of restlessness. And unfortunately, before this was well understood, these people will sometimes get more restless because they're having a side effect. And so what they did is they increased the dose, and rather than that helping, made things worse. Yeah, you can have dystonias, which can come on very suddenly or develop over a period of several hours. These are they're like muscle spasms, and there's this one particular ocular motor dystonic reaction. And I saw this once and it scared the hell out of me. I was mopping floors in the state hospital, and this guy's walking down the hallway, and all of a sudden his eyes roll up into the back of his head, and all you can see are the white of his eyes. Woo! I've seen all these movies about sight and madness and all this kind of stuff. Whoa! And that also kind of scares family members too. But what you get, these really intense muscle spasms, especially in the neck. That can be not dangerous, but very painful. Okay. Parkinsonian symptoms would include tremors, and with Parkinsonian symptoms, people oftentimes they call it a pill rolling tremor. It's as if you had a round pill in your hand and you were doing this, okay? So people sitting around with Parkinson's disease or taking typical antipsychotics would do this. Now, one thing that's interesting about tremors is if you have tremors that are due to anxiety, the person's going like this, but when you do something, like pick something up, it gets worse, okay? It gets worse. I remember the first time I gave a talk before a large group of people, I was very nervous, and I went like this, and I started actually spilling water. It was quite embarrassing. Parkinsonian tremors, they get the tremor, you do something, and when you do something, it stops. So that's one way to discriminate. Is this anxiety-related, or is this an extrapyramidal symptom? rigidity. Some people just can't move. Severe Parkinson's disease. Is difficulty initiating movement. Once they start moving, they move. But let me show you. This is a normal, well, semi-normal psychologist walking, okay, like this. Here's a psychologist who's taken a bunch of Haldol.
So I'm not swinging my arms, I'm shuffling my gait and that kind of stuff.
And then probably the worst one of all is tardive dyskinesia, where people get persistent motor abnormalities. And these really have a huge impact on how people are perceived by others. So if you're trying to reintegrate somebody into society, like get a job, for instance, and they're smacking and sticking their tongue out, you know, and writhing like this all the time. What's interesting is most people have tardive dyskinesia. It doesn't even bother them. They kind of just don't notice it. But it's like, God, there's something wrong with this person. So a significant number of people who've developed tardive dyskinesia, if you stop the medicine, it wouldn't go away. Sometimes it gets better, but sometimes it would be persistent. So those are really bad side effects, obviously, when you block dopamine receptors in the extrapyramidal system. You block dopamine receptors in the frontal lobes, and you get what's called hypofrontality. And it just shuts down the frontal lobes. And this is responsible for a lot of negative symptoms. Instead of having all these crazy ideas going through their head with negative symptoms, it's like they call it poverty of thought. If you try to find out what they're thinking, they're not thinking anything. It's like there's no one home. And you also see anhedonia, apathy, you know, lack of motivation, and so forth. So in the mid-50s, when the first antipsychotics were discovered, it was a godsend, because they didn't have, except for frontal lobotomies, they, you know, for schizophrenia, they didn't really have any treatment. But you got a lot of these additional symptoms that we're talking about. That's not the only symptoms, but those are the extrapyramidal symptoms. Okay, with the new or so-called atypical antipsychotics, now the reason they call them atypical versus typical, the typical were the first generation, like Thorazine, Haldol, Prolixin, Stelzine, and that kind of stuff. The newer ones coming out starting in 1994 are called the atypical. The only thing that's really atypical, well, the main thing is atypical about it, is they have very low rates of extrapyramidal side effects, and that's good. That's good news. And but it's not zero. And if you look at all the new antipsychotics, and I'll show you a list here in just a minute, there one of them, if you get push the dose up a little bit, you get a modest amount of extrapyramidal symptoms, and it's Risperdal. Okay, the only one that has zero extrapyramidal symptoms is Clozaril. Okay. Also, the hope was that the new antipsychotics, because they had a different kind of effect on the extrapyramidal system, would not cause tardive dyskinesia. That's not entirely true. On the old generation antipsychotics, tardive dyskinesia occurred in 7% of people per year. And if you had to stay on it for a lifetime, eventually at least 50% of people would develop that. So longer term exposure, and you were having hundreds of thousands of people who were living with this persistent bizarre movement disorder. Okay, with the new atypical antipsychotics, it's somewhat less than 1% per year. So if people say it doesn't cause tardive dyskinesia, that's not exactly true. It causes it, but at much, much, much lower rates. Okay, but it's not zero, except Clozaril. Okay, Clozaril, no extrapyramidal side effects, no tardive dyskinesia. Okay, so when they say atypical, all that really means is it doesn't have that same negative effect in the extrapyramidal system. Now, so if you give these drugs, then it largely leaves the extrapyramidal system or vagal ganglia alone. Okay, it calms down activity in the limbic system, which reduces negative symptoms. It probably doesn't have much effect on the frontal lobes, except Clozaril, which seems to improve negative symptoms. Okay, I keep saying Clozaril again and again. Clozaril is in a class all by itself. It's considered to be an atypical because it doesn't affect the extrapyramidal system. But the problem with Clozaril is it's got huge side effects. It has weight gain is substantial. anticholinergic effects. What? Yes. Right. Yeah, she's saying drooling. That's another one with the Clozaril. Right. anticholinergic effects, constipation, okay, blurry vision, increased rate of spontaneous seizures. Doesn't sound too good, right? And 2% of people treated with this drug would develop agranulocytosis. And this is in, you probably already read this in your book, but agranulocytosis interferes with the immune system, and if you don't treat it, it'll kill you. Okay? So what has been mandated then by the FDA is for the first 6 months of treatment, weekly blood tests have to be done to measure white blood cell count, because if you catch agranulocytosis in the early stages, stop the medicine, then nobody dies. Okay? After 6 months, you go to every other week. But what it means for the rest of your life, if you've got to constantly be checking for the possibility of this blood disease, okay? And I will tell you, as bad as it sounds, Clozaril is an absolute godsend for some people when nothing else works, because it is effective for treatment-resistant schizophrenia. It is effective for schizophrenia with predominant negative symptoms. Now, I have to say about half of the people that have negative symptoms improve on Clozaril, but it's really the only antipsychotic that has an impact on that. Okay, it's effective for treatment-resistant mania and treatment-resistant depression. So there's a broad range of disorders. So let me say that again. Schizophrenia with negative symptoms, depression, and mania. And for people that have failed to respond to anything, this is kind of the lowest on the list in terms of choices, but it can be a significant medication for those kind of people. Okay, so decrease EPS extrapyramidal symptoms, okay. D2 is considered to be the primary dopamine receptor that when you block it, you get antipsychotic effects. It has an effect on serotonin receptors, and then I mentioned these other features as well. Okay, so here's the list of atypical antipsychotics. Clozaril is not on here. It technically is an atypical because it doesn't affect the extrapyramidal system, but it's actually been around for really quite a long time. But these started coming on the market in 1994. The newest ones just got released at the end of 2009, Fanapt and Safras. Okay, and I have very little information about these drugs. I want to talk, though, about a drug that seems to be, it's in this class, but it has a different mechanism of action, which is interesting, okay? What's interesting about Abilify is when there are, in the frontal lobes, when there are, and the limbic system, when there are concentrations of dopamine that are too low, then it blocks dopamine receptors. Excuse me, let me start over again. I got to think about this, okay? When there's too much dopamine, it blocks dopamine receptors, okay? And that's what normal antipsychotics do. When there's too little dopamine, which can shut down the frontal lobes, it activates the release of dopamine. It's kind of like a thermostat that, you set it at a certain temperature, it gets a little too hot, turns on the air conditioner. It's a little too cool, turns on the heater. And so it's got a really kind of clever and different mechanism of action. And the real advantages of Abilify are that it doesn't cause weight gain, and most of the others do. Okay. Secondly, it can really activate people if they are really slowed down, people that are just, in a sort of vegetative state, staring off into space and that sort of thing. It can really bring them alive. Now, unfortunately, it can also jazz people up. It can make them a little too anxious and can cause some akathisia. But I think the main benefit of Abilify is its ability to activate people and no weight gain.